You know, you've been channeling Bashar now for almost 40 years at this point. Can you tell me why he chose now to send his message in the scope of humanity's history right now?
God, look what's going on our planet.
I mean, a couple things.
not too much. It's a very dull place. I think, first of all, our, in a sense, invitation energetically to extraterrestrials by starting to explore space, that we are becoming aware we're not the only planet around, probably not the only civilization. That kind of triggers a message to them energetically that we might be ready for some form of connection, some form of dialogue, to see whether we want to move forward with the idea of contact or not. So that's one thing. Secondly, obviously, we are in need of different tools at this point. In the 21st century, we have to sort of let go of a lot of outdated and old-fashioned definitions and ideas. And they recognize that now is the time to introduce some new ideas and definitions. And hopefully that makes a change in our reality, or at least some people's reality, to, again, sort of change our vibration and bring us closer to the possibility of making contact with them.
So let me ask you then, because you said something that's interesting, that we have to let go of old ideas, things that aren't serving us anymore. But so many of these ideas, these things that we're doing, are so entrenched that it's almost impossible at this point, unless there's a group collective choosing of change. Kind of like, I think when the pandemic happened, it was the first big shock to the system, where now people are working from home, people are reevaluating their lives. It was that giant break that the entire planet essentially needed. It was very odd. It's never happened in human history, to my understanding.
Not certainly in this way. But again, they take advantage of those kinds of things. They recognize that is a psychological change, a shift, where people start looking for different things, start opening up to different ideas. And so they're willing to sort of use that and see what we're willing to absorb. But it doesn't have to necessarily happen all at once collectively. You know, the more individuals change themselves, then it over time, it becomes a collective. Just like anything, each generation starts becoming a new collective. With new ideas. I mean, think about it this way, really, you know, since, the late 60s, there has been no one born who doesn't think we haven't been in space, right? So it's like, you know, when I was born, that was not something that was true. But, you know, now, what, 30-year-olds, 40-year-olds, 50-year-olds have always thought that we've been in space. So that's a big shift in our collective consciousness and an opening, like I said, kind of an invitation for other beings to recognize that we may be ready for more awareness of what's in space.
So is, because a lot of the ideas and messages that Bashar puts out, they are, you know, talking about space and talking about technology to a certain extent, but it's all about internal growth, internal evolution of the human soul and humanity in general. I have to ask, why do they care? Why even bother? We're savages.
Well, in some senses, without going into a deeper explanation of this story, we are family with them. So they see us that way. And we have actually some genetic connection to his civilization. That's a big story, a long story. But they do see us as family, and they are trying to help. They know what it's like to be part of a larger galactic community. They know what it can do for a civilization in terms of changing their perspective and outlook on life. And so, but again, they're not forcing us to do anything, which is why they're sort of staying in the background and just delivering information in various ways, like through channels and so on and so forth, to see what we're willing to take on, what we're willing to grab onto. And then decide for ourselves whether we want to go farther. But from their perspective, the kind of civilization they are passionate about helping people wake up. It's just the way that they're oriented, because they know what it's done for them to have evolved to this point where they expand their consciousness and what's available to someone when their consciousness is open. And, you know, again, they're not forcing us to take their word for it, but they're saying, here's a toolkit. And if you apply this in your life, you'll prove to yourself that there are other ways that you can live. And maybe that will make a difference in how you experience life on your world. So it's just the way they operate.
So when you said awake, and that's something, I mean, I have a book right behind me that says awake and awaken, and yogis have been talking about it for 5,000 years to awaken out of Maya and this this illusion. And it's been many different philosophies and religions over the years. Can you explain, when you say awake, is that a word that's been coined now? It's simulation theory, which is essentially Maya, which we are in an illusion. Is that what you mean by awake? You're awakening to the reality of, oh, this isn't real. We are in this different level of existence, but this is not the end all be all.
Yeah, that's part of it. And I would say when we use the word illusion, I want to be careful, because it's not that the experience of physical reality isn't real.
Sure.
The experience is very real. But we are, according to him, and like you said, many other teachers over time, we are the ones creating this illusion. It's a projection of consciousness.
Right.
In fact, I just saw a recent article that, you know, even quantum physics is starting to catch up to the idea that, hey, all of this is just a holographic projection of some sort from somewhere. So even science is starting to talk about the ephemeral nature of physical reality. And so, yeah, it's about becoming aware that what we experience in life is our creation, and that it's determined by what we believe to be true about ourselves and what kind of process we're attempting to experience to help ourselves learn and grow. From Bashar's point of view, that's the whole point of physical reality. It's sort of like forgetting that you're an expanded being so that you can rediscover that you're an expanded being from another perspective. And that's how creation expands, because the structure of existence, according to him, never changes. It is what it is. But your relationship to it, your experience of it, your perspective of it changes. And that's how creation grows. And so the idea of going through these physical experiences, these limited experiences, with the attempt or potential to break through that illusion and realize that you have created this for yourself for a specific purpose, really expands your consciousness, gives you a whole different perspective on life, and just makes things a lot more understandable.
To watch the full video, click on the link below, and don't forget to subscribe.